undergo arthroscopic surgery on that right shoulder. He's on the shelf for the season. The Mets will have to make do, and they've made do very well with Howard Johnson at shortstop. No score here in the bottom of the first. It'll be Mike Buffy Lacoste. 4-2 record. He lost to the Mets 10-9 12 days ago at Candlestick Park. That was the game, you remember, that Kevin McReynolds had the two home runs.
And he'll be pitching against this Mets lineup. Darryl Boston leading off in center field, batting second. Dave Magadan at first base, batting third. Jeffries at third base. Strawberry in right, batting fourth. Batting fifth, McReynolds in left. Johnson batting sixth, playing shortstop. Tuffle batting seventh at second base. Huntley, the catcher, batting eighth. And Sid Fernandez.
And the first pitch of the ball game to the Mets hitters is a strike on the outside corner. Darryl Boston with a game-winning hit in last night's game, a game won by the Mets 2-1 over the Padres. 0-1 to Boston. And it's 1-1, and with the Labor Day weekend, the telethon, the Jerry Lewis telethon, and Ben Vereen throwing out the first pitch tonight. Big fan, and have been for a long time, and Ben will be in our booth shortly as the splitter swung and missed. 1-2 to Darryl Boston. Roger Craig, the manager of the Giants, of course, he had his hands full all season long. 36 roster changes by the Giants this year.
15 players on the DL, that's a Giant record, and it's the most in the National League.
2-2 to Darryl Boston. No score here in the first inning. Mets 52-33 under Buddy Harrelson. Breaking ball, high chopper to third. Williams got him. Good play by Matt Williams.
Williams, an outstanding third baseman. And he has a gun for an arm, and he had to use it here. High chopper, he has to wait for it to come down. He gets in the good throwing position and then burns it across for the out. Oh, he's going to be some ball player.
Already is. Dave Magadan now the batter. High ball one. Betting 333 on the season, and with Willie McGee traded to the Oakland Athletics now, Magadan is second in the National League. How about that trade? Now, when you think about it, McGee with Oakland, Felix Jose going over to the Cardinals with a couple of minor leaguers. Here's a guy who could have won the batting title in the National League, and he was traded before the deadline, the August 31st deadline. Technically could end the season ahead of Ricky Henderson of Oakland and yet not be able to win the batting title because he changed leagues.
Wouldn't qualify in the American League. He has won one batting title in his National League career.
85, he was the most valuable player for the Cardinals. Outside, ball three, 3-1 to Magadan.
Matter of fact, after that year, he never hit 300 again, and this year he will have the 300 mark.
Gregg Jeffries on deck. There's a strike, 3-2 to Dave. There have been two players in the history of Major League Baseball to win the batting title during the season while traded to another club. Dale Alexander did it, traded from Detroit to Boston in 1932, and Harry Walker did it. He went from the Cardinals to the Phillies in 1947 as Magadan walked, first base runner for the Mets.
Magadan gets his 57th walk. He came into this game with a 22, second in the National League to Lenny Dykstra. He quietly is on base time after time after time.
And Gregg Jeffries now the batter. Gregg slipping below that 300 mark. having a fine year, moving to third base tonight. I would imagine he's much more comfortable over on the left side of the infield.
He really looks more comfortable over there.
That one almost hit him, ball one.
He looks like he belongs at third. He's always sort of struggling at second, although he's improved considerably at second base. But at third base, he played a lot of third base in the minor leagues, so he knows the position much better. It's not as hard to play at second.
Requires a much stronger arm, of course. Fastball, swing and a miss. 1-1 to Gregg Jeffries. No score here in the first inning. Darryl Strawberry on deck. Retrieves it quickly. So the Mets with runners at first and second. One out, and Darryl Strawberry coming up.
Well, Jeffries with three hits in last night's ball game picks up another here. Came into this game hitting 298, so he's working to get that average over 300.
So Jeffries with the first net hit as it is at first base, Magadan at second, and Strawberry the batter. Darryl has had its problems recently, only three home runs since July 23rd. And Gary Carter wants to talk to Mike Lacoss. Lacoss, the type of pitcher that Strawberry can handle, don't you think, Ralph? That low fastball, power the other way.
Change of speeds and very careful about where he puts the balls. He doesn't give up many home runs.
Matter of fact, Lacoste has only given up two home runs this year, both to Kevin McReynolds in that Sunday game at Candlestick. Sharply up the middle, base hit. Magadan's going to score. Jeffries will try to go to third and make it. 1-0 Mets.
Well, Darryl picked up his 81st run batted in. It's his 8th hit in 23 at-bats against Lacoste. He has not hit a home run off of him. But a big RBI right here, and what's more important, Jeffries going from first to third on the single to center.
So good base running by Jeffries and Kevin McReynolds, who is Lacoste's nemesis at Candlestick, is now the batter. McReynolds with six RBIs in that game, a game again won by the Mets 10-9.
McReynolds hit those two home runs off Lacoste. He had not had a home run since July the 3rd, and then he went down and hit two more against the Dodgers. So he had two games in which he had two home runs on that last road trip.
High ball two, 2-0. That was really a strange week for Kevin. He had the two home runs on Sunday night against the Giants. Then he went 0-for-19. And then hit two home runs against the Dodgers.
Didn't have a hit in the San Diego series.
No. Two balls, no strikes to McReynolds. 1-0 Mets. 2-1. Howard Johnson on deck. Ball three, 3-1 to
last two games of Lacoss has started, the Giants have scored 22 runs. And Lacoss's record is one win and one loss.
Reynolds has struggled here at Shea. There goes Strawberry. Fastball lifted to center. Strawberry will have to retreat. Jeffries is going to try it. The throw home. In there. 2-0 New York as Strawberry goes to second.
Well, this is winning tight baseball. Ball isn't too deep in center field. I think Butler was surprised that Jeffries even tried, and the throw is a weak throw. It's not handled by Carter.
In between hop,
gets away. Strawberry, who was halfway running on the pitch, stops and goes back to first and tags up, and then goes down to second on the throw home. A good alert base running by Darryl Strawberry, and the Mets taking that extra base and helping themselves out.
First, Jeffries, as you pointed out, took the extra base going to third, and now Jeffries comes home on a shallow fly ball. Strawberry at second, and the curve to Howard Johnson is wide. Hojo with problems, his left elbow is giving him problems. It hurts him more swinging from the left side than from the right side, he told me before the game. Much better now than it was a month ago. He doesn't believe that he will require surgery during the offseason. The splitter is low. 2-0 to Johnson.
Johnson has had two home runs against Lacoste in his major league career.
Curveball is over. 2-1 to Howard Johnson. The Mets with two here in the first inning lead the Giants 2-0. And Tim Tuffle on deck. Playing Johnson in shallow fashion makes the play. But the Mets scored two on two hits and Strand won and lead 2-0 after one. And we're back after this from Hess Gasoline. Tonight that the Mets have always done well when Ben Vereen shows up at the ballpark. Right here,
right.
2-0 after one. And we'd like to welcome to our telecast Ben Vereen, who will be hosting the telethon, the Jerry Lewis telethon, on Sunday night that will go on through Monday evening.
That's right, starting at 9 o'clock, 9 p.m., and going through till Monday.
You know, are you ready for that?
Yeah, a lot of black coffee. Yeah. Stay up all night and raise some money for Jerry's kids and all of our children. This is wonderful. And the Mets have donated their time. They'll be coming out and also doing the telethon. So I want to thank them right now. You know, they're really showing that Met spirit, that New York Met spirit. So it's really great because they're wonderful form tonight. They're looking great.
They really
they're
are.
They're looking terrific.
Matt Williams is swinging a miss, 0-1. Sid Fernandez staked to a 2-0 lead. Williams with 26 home runs and 97 RBIs. To Matt Williams. Foul back, 0-2. You looked in fine form tonight, throwing out the first pitch.
Yeah, it was strange. Pitcher said, don't throw it too hard.
You got a tender hand.
Yeah.
You know, Ben, I've seen you, obviously, many times in Las Vegas, and you had to be a terrific athlete. You are a terrific athlete, but did you play sports when you were growing up?
I was a track and field man.
Yeah, you had to be.
Yeah. I was a little too short for football and basketball.
This one fell back right
below. Yeah, almost caught it.
Listen, last year, or 2 years ago, actually, Robin Williams. No, it was last year. Robin Williams and Billy Crystal were up here. And Robin Williams, it was his second major league game, and we had a foul ball in the booth. So that might have been an omen that week. And when you haven't been to that many major league games for the first time at Shea, it was Robin's first time at Shea.
That is a good omen.
Yeah.
That is a good
foul ball in the booth, and Robin got a foul ball in his second major league game and first time at Shea. And it's your first time
That's
at Shea, right.
right? That's right. It is.
Our
it's a fine ballpark.
Ben Vereen, it really is. Great shape. Another big crowd on hand. About 35,000 tonight.
Well, you know, New Yorkers love their Mets.
They sure do. Love their Yankees. They love the Dodgers and the Giants before the Giants moved to California.
You know, it's hard to get anybody from Brooklyn to talk about the Dodgers.
It really is.
Yeah, yeah.
Really
I'm from
is.
Brooklyn. I don't talk about them.
That was a disaster when they moved from Ebbets Field to the Coliseum out in L.A.
Still 1-2 to Matt Williams. 2-0 Mets here in the second. And the curve got it.
Woo.
Two strikeouts now. For Fernandez. Here's that form we were talking about. Ben Vereen throwing out the first ball tonight.
All right. See my wind, this is my wind up. I'd warmed up before this. That's what he says. Don't hurt me.
Listen, with all that wind up, he had to be worried.
So please, don't hurt me.
You ever play in any of those Dodger, when they have the Hollywood stars out there playing baseball at Dodger Stadium? Did you ever play in any games there?
No, I never did. Never did. But I tell you, I'll be playing in them when the Mets have them back home here.
Outside to Gary Carter. Gary playing in his 1,894th game.
Most ever played.
National League record.
Because he can. I don't think he's going to last long enough to break the all-time record.
Outside, ball two to Gary. Bob Boone now with right around 2,200 games caught. It's a lot of time squatting. It's almost as many times as you played on Broadway in Pippin. Wasn't
That's
that your
right.
First, wasn't that your first play?
Yeah, except I got to move around. It was squat all the time.
Chance to loosen up a little
yeah.
bit.
Yeah.
3-0 to Gary Carter.
Carter with 285 home runs as a catcher. That's fourth in the all-time list. The all-time leader, Carlton Fisk, who just went by Johnny Bench. Bench had 327.
Strike one, 3-1. Gary Carter, Ben and Ralph, he's lasted this long because he's really had fun playing. Do you have fun performing? Do you consider
I love performing.
Is it work or play?
It's play for me, and I'm getting paid to play at what I love. And that's what's so great, you know. And you'll see that on the telephone, you know. That's why I'm excited about it. I'll get an opportunity to go all night and be with my friends too. We got great acts coming out, like Kitten Play's going to be there, Stanley Tarantino's coming out, practically all of the Broadway shows, Les Miserables, Phantom's coming out, Forever Plaid, Rothschild. We've got a wonderful lineup, I'm glad to say, for New York. And we're going to have ourselves a real good time. We're going to raise a lot of money this year. We need a lot of money this year because wheelchairs have gone up for these kids.
Swing and a miss. Carter down on strikes again. Now three strikeouts for Fernandez. And two outs here in the second inning.
That has been a tremendous fundraiser over the years, hasn't it?
It has been, but this year is a very important year. Because research, as I said, the wheelchairs have gone up. When they started the telethon, it was $1,000 for an electric chair. The price today starts at $8,000 for an electric chair
wow.
for a kid.
Wow.
Research has gone up, and the cost of everything has gone up. So we're going to really need people to really pitch in and dig down this year because MDA covers 40 different kinds of diseases, and we don't know how many of them are hereditary. You never know. And, you know, the Lou Gehrig disease is one, the Duchenne. It is 40 other, that's 38 other different kinds of diseases that MDA is working with. And it's about us, the people. It's not government funded. It comes from the people. We're the ones that keep the scientists there, and we're the ones that are helping make the miracle.
Two balls, no strikes to Robbie Thompson. Robbie with 13 home runs on the year. 2-0 Mets here in the top of the second inning.
Well, Ben, we'll probably send you. What do you need, about 5 gallons of coffee to make that nice?
Would you do that for me, please? Stop.
Industrial strength.
Industrial strength coffee. I want the leaded coffee, not the unleaded coffee now, please.
2-1 to Thompson with Jose Uribe on deck. Telethon will start on Sunday night. And
9 p.m.
and end Monday?
Monday at 7.
Foul back, 2-2 to Thompson.
you have a great seat here.
Until the foul ball
comes. That's right.
Then you duck.
We know full well that those balls, when they hit, they stick and hurt.
Oh, yes, they do.
You know, everybody else dies for them. They barehanded catches. Tim and I, we just get out of the way.
Yeah, I just thought they just clobbered some lady over here on the foul ball.
Sid Fernandez strikes out the side here in the second inning. Looks like Ben Vereen will be trying to strike out all the dreaded diseases on Sunday night. The telethon starting it off against Mike Lacoss, and promptly spanks one hard to Matt Williams at third. One out. Hit like a bullet.
Reaction time zero, just about. Like a rocket going off, and it's right into the glove of Matt Williams, who makes an excellent play. Boy, that reaction is really quick. Tuffel hit in tough luck in yesterday's ballgame, and it's a tough job for Tuffel. He's trying to get it going, trying to stay in the lineup, and now in the last two games, he's hit two bullets, and they've both been caught.
Change that to Tuffel luck.
Mm.
Todd Hundley now. 2-0 Mets here in the second. Fly ball that is tailing foul and out of play. So 0-1 to Todd. I had mentioned when Ben Vereen was with us in the top of the inning that the telethon would start on Sunday at 9 o'clock and end on Tuesday. Well, a correction on that. That'd be too long. That'd be a real telethon. It will start at 9 o'clock Sunday evening, the Jerry Lewis telethon hosted in New York by Ben Vereen. And it will end at 7 o'clock on Monday evening as Brett Butler tracks down the Hundley drive. Two outs here in the second inning.
He is such a talented guy.
Wow, I'll say.
What a lovely man.
Mm-hmm. But you're right about him being an athlete. I did not see Pippen, but you remember him, Roots Chicken Little on television, the highest rated show ever on television. And the man can dance. Mm. The man can dance, I'm telling you. Look at Fernandez hitting one hard to right field, and he's going to stop it at first base.
That is if he gets there.
Sid content with a single.
Satisfied with a single as Sid gets his ninth hit. And the Mets get their third hit in the ballgame. Sid staying right on this pitch. He looks like a major league hitter right here. He stays on the breaking ball and lines it into right field.
So Fernandez at first base, two outs, and Darryl Boston the batter. Darryl hit a high chopper to Matt Williams in the first inning. But then Magadan walked. Jeffries and Strawberry singled, and a sacrifice fly by Kevin McReynolds plated Jeffries on an outstanding piece of base running by Gregg. Ball and no strikes to Darryl Boston. Fly ball, shallow left. Mitchell in for the third out. Still 2-0 New York after two. We're back after this from Nissan. Faye Vincent, of course, the commissioner, his wife Valerie seated next to him, and Faye's two sisters, one of whom is from Syracuse, his brother-in-law there with his arms folded. He has had a very active year with the Steinbrenner affair most recently. And out to enjoy a ball game on a beautiful evening here at Shea as Jose Uribe leads it off against Fernandez and takes ball one.
He's really had his hands full with a baseball lockout, and then, of course, the other things that have taken place, part of the Pete Rose decision.
1-1 to Uribe, and don't forget, almost a year ago to the day, it'll be 1 year on Saturday, tragic untimely death of Bart Giamatti, the commissioner of baseball, last September 1st. Faye Vincent's close friend. And then Commissioner Vincent voted in by the owners. It was almost a formality, really. No, nobody came in second.
He was the deputy commissioner at the time. Steve Greenberg, Hank Greenberg's son, is now the new deputy commissioner.
Fouled out of play. So it's 2-2 to Jose Uribe. I saw Will Clark over talking to the commissioner before the game tonight, and I couldn't help but think of Will Clark catching that foul ball in the fourth game of the World Series last year and plopping right in the commissioner's lap. Inside, ball 3-2.
Yeah, that was another one of his big problems after the earthquake in San Francisco, whether or not to continue the World Series or whether to drop it at that point.
Talking about how baseball was the folks in baseball and the sport itself, the guests of the people in the Bay Area, as Uribe walked. So he's the second base runner of the game for the Giants, and that'll bring up Mike Lacoss. Well, his first major league game, Julio Valera. Youngster will be starting on Saturday. Well, imagine the excitement, even though he's not showing a lot, is he?
No, he's got it. He looks like he might even be a little scared. 10-10 at Tidewater this year. Fine pitcher for the Mets in their Tidewater AAA operation.
His earned run average of 3.02. Lacoste probably bunting, and he showed bun as Fernandez goes to first. 2-0 Mets.
Lacoste is 1-for-15.
With a two-run lead, the one thing you want to make sure of is to get an out on this play. It's not as important when you have a two-run lead to get the lead runner, especially with Fernandez on the mound, a poor fielder. Strike one.
Lacoste has had one home run, and it was hit off Dane Orge. And if you say Dane Orge, a pitcher, you're right. He was an outfielder, but he was brought in to pitch in the game won by San Francisco 18-1. And he hit a home run off Dane.
And the bunt's a good one. Jeffries wanted to go to second, but throws wide to first. A nice play by Tuffle. One out.
Good job by Tuffle getting to this throw. As Jeffries, in his haste to try and get the force play at second, had a little trouble fielding the ball and getting it out of his glove. You see it in the tip of his glove there. Now he changes his mind, and rightfully so, and almost throws it away.
He also had Fernandez there. Watch the impediment of Sid Fernandez there. If you're a pitcher, you got to get down.
Sid was in the way on a bunt play by Brett Butler as he led off the ball game, and Butler had an infield hit. There's Sid. He can't root. He's got to throw over Sid, and that isn't easy.
So he went for the sure out, and that's the right thing to do, is Brett Butler the batter. He had a bunt base hit to open the game for the Giants. Ball one outside. Gotta love the way Darryl Boston is playing center field. McReynolds in and Boston in. Very shallow outfield against Butler, who has only two home runs, so why not? Including the catcher, Todd Hundley.
He was crossed up on that pitch, so he goes out to make sure that the signs are understood. Watch him. He's looking fastball. Now watch how he moves to his right and has to come back to his left to get that curveball. He's looking fastball all the way. You can do that on the curve because you have a little time. If it's the other way around and you thought you called for a curve and they throw a fastball, you're in deep trouble.
Like a train going through the station. Ding, 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 ding. You're looking for the local and you get the express. A frightening feeling. Two balls and a strike to Brett Butler. 2-0 Mets here in the third. One on, one out for the Giants. First of four here at Shea. Inside, ball three to Butler.
Butler's been a hot batter. He had a 10-game hitting streak stop last night. In his last 11 games, hitting 366, and he had a bunt base hit in this game. He's had 75 walks this year. Time for the lead, leg lead.
3-2 to Butler.
Both he and Dykstra with 75 walks, Bonds with 74.
Ball four, that ball was inside. Had that defensive swing. And Fernandez wants another ball. Kevin Baez called when the Mets recalled. Actually called up for the first time when Mario Diaz was sent down to Jackson. So Diaz out, Baez up.
Baez, born and raised in Brooklyn.
Went to Lafayette High School in Brooklyn. Butler again going for ball four. The fifth strikeout by Sid Fernandez. Two outs here in the third inning. Just a satisfying for Fernandez. That's what those S's are. Five strikeouts now. And Hundley again wanting to make sure about the sign. Pittsburgh idle on the evening, so if the Mets win, they will pick up a half a game on the Pirates. The Pirates resume play tomorrow night in Houston. Gregg Litton now the batter. Litton a strikeout victim in the first. Has shown control with the curveball early in the early going.
That's the same pitch that Litton was called out on strike.
Uribe at second. Two outs. 2-0 New York here in the third. No balls. Two strikes to Gregg. That verification that you have to start to hit effectively. Almost all hitters will tell you that. Coming off the bench and trying to hit well, very tough. He goes after a high fastball. That's six strikeouts now for Fernandez as the Giants fail to score in the third. 2-0 Mets after 2.5, and Ralph and I will be back after this from DHL Courier Service. Magadan leads it off for the Mets. Magadan walked and scored the first run of the game, scoring on an RBI single by Darryl Strawberry. Inside, ball one. Of a four-game series here at Shea Stadium. Frank Viola goes against Don Robinson tomorrow night. And then Julio Valera's first major league start against John Burkett on Saturday. David Cohn against Scott Gorelt on Sunday. Strike two to Magadan. Still plenty of seats available for all three games. Then the Mets go on the road to St. Louis, Pittsburgh. Two in St. Louis, three in Pittsburgh, and three in Philadelphia before returning home. Inside, ball two. Two and two to Magadan.
Lacoss really trying to stay inside on Magadan. You'll find most of the pitchers are going to be pitching him inside more and more, and that's when he can probably start to turn on the ball and hit with more power.
Outside, ball three, three and two to Magadan. For the second time in a row, walk. That'll bring up Gregg Jeffries.
And checking out the Nissan National League scoreboard, the Dodgers and Phillies tied at one. The bottom of the second, the Dodgers 5.5 games back to Cincinnati. St. Louis won, Atlanta won, bottom half of the third. Cincinnati no score after 1.5 innings. They're playing in Chicago. And as Tim pointed out, Pittsburgh not playing. Not on the schedule today.
Jeffries, a single up the middle, followed by an RBI single by Strawberry in the first inning. That was the first run. Then a sack fly by Kevin McReynolds, driving in Jeffries. And it's 2-0 Mets and 0-1 to Gregg Jeffries.
Mike Lacoss, the last pitcher to face Mike Schmidt. That played in San Francisco. Went to San Diego after that series and announced his retirement.
I think it was John Franco catching it barehanded. Nope, Alejandro Pena. 4-0 New York.
Hit off of Lacoste this year, three, and all by the Mets, one by Jeffries and two by McReynolds.
Here's Strawberry, an RBI single his first time up, takes ball one.
And Jeffries gets this breaking ball and stays right on it, drills it out in the right center field. No chance for Litton to make the catch, and the catch is made by Pena out in the bullpen.
This ball hit deep to center, but it's playable as Butler makes the play, one away. I said that Pena caught it barehanded. I think he had the glove on, but it was not a clean catch. Check it out. Yeah, he had the glove between his hands.
That's what they call playing perfect position. Sitting there making the catch right in the seat. That's what you call. That does not tie a club record for second baseman, as he's playing third base tonight, and that home run doesn't count.
Jeffries has 13 home runs as a second baseman, one as a third base. That's a Mets record, 14 by Tim Tuffle and Jerry Buchek. Inside, ball one, 1-1 to McReynolds as Howard Johnson is on deck.
Ryan Sandberg hit a home run yesterday for his 30th of the year and became the first second baseman to hit 30 home runs in back-to-back seasons.
This one scalded to left, but Mitchell backtracking makes the play. Two out. Boy, they are hitting a lot of balls awfully hard.
And the record for home runs, total home runs in the season by a second baseman is 42, held by Rogers Hornsby and Davey Johnson. Yes, the Davey Johnson that was the manager of the Mets. Davey that year hit 43 home runs, but one of them came as a pinch hitter, so he only got credit for 42 while playing at second base.
Outside to Johnson. Hojo line to left his first at bat. 4-0 now. Mets on top. Trying to go to within 1.5 of the Pirates, who are idle this evening. Fouled out of play. Tim Tuffle on deck. Will Clark, who makes the play. The Mets have only one hit in the third, but it's a booming homer by Gregg Jeffries. 4-0 New York, and we'll be back after this.
Okay, Tim, and Will Clark will lead it off. Clark hitting 286 in the year with 16 home runs, 77 runs batted in. And he goes after the fastball and misses strike one. Clark rounded out the short his first time up. He leads the club in strikeouts. He has 83. Rather surprising stat. Second in the National League in hitting last year to Tony Gwynn. And the breaking ball is called a ball. It's one ball and one strike.
I talked with Will before the game about that, and he said that the biggest difference between this year and last year is that this year he's not getting his flares. He said last year he hit for a high average because he had a lot of broken bat hits the other way and things of that nature. Not so this year.
And he pops up this pitch, a fastball, and the play is made by Jeffries in foul territory. So Clark out for the second time, one away here in the fourth. Mets leading 4-0, and Kevin Mitchell will be the batter. Mitchell on a check swing, grounded out with a runner at third in the first inning.
In order for a major league hitter to have a good year and to hit over 300, you got to get the cheap hits. The guys who can run real well get cheap hits on infield plays that normally would be out for most guys, but they outrun the ball.
Case in point will be Willie McGee, who has just been traded by St. Louis to Oakland. And the first pitch occurred for ball one to Mitchell. Mitchell hitting 306 with 30 home runs, 79 runs batted in. And he goes right through the fastball, 1-1.
That's the thing that is against Dave Magadan winning the batting crown, is he's not going to get many leg hits, whereas Lynn Dykstra would. Mitchell had an idea of getting the Giants off snide with that swing.
Ball again, it's fouled back. Mitchell with a great year last year. Batted 291 for San Francisco with 47 home runs, 125 RBIs. Was the MVP. He led the major leagues in all five major categories in hitting, home runs, runs batted in, slugging, total bases, and extra base hits. Became the eighth player to do that. Pitch close, but call the ball 2-2. Before Mitchell hit the 47 home runs last year for the Giants. The most he'd ever hit in the season was 19. He really found himself last season. The 2-2 pitch. The curve, and that's all. Sixth strikeout for Sid Fernandez.
American League Nissan scoreboard shows the White Sox over Minnesota. Chicago trying to still stay with the Athletics, who also won over Kansas City 6-5. Baltimore over New York 2-0 in the third. 2-0 Cleveland over Boston in the fourth inning. And Detroit at Seattle later on this evening.
White Sox remaining 6.5 games back of Oakland. And the first pitch to Matt Williams is fouled away, strike one. Williams struck out looking at a curveball his first time up. Williams tied for the league lead in RBIs with 97. Barry Bonds and Joe Carter also with 97 RBIs. And Barry Bonds having an MVP year. The fastball, a ball. Mets with 8 games left with the Pirates. 6 of them in Pittsburgh. And 3 of them next week. Off-speed pitch and a called strike, so it's 1-2. Sid has given up just one hit at one base hit to the leadoff batter in this ball game. In that Oakland game, Jim, Ricky Henderson hit a leadoff home run, his 45th leadoff home run. That is an all-time record. The old record held by Bobby Bonds, and it was 35.
Now, he's the best leadoff hitter in the history of the game. I think you'd say that without even giving it any more thought than that.
No argument.
No. Who was better?
I don't know how you can beat him. He has power. He's going to be the all-time stolen base leader. Just a matter of time there. Here's the 1-2 pitch. Going on a miss. And this time, Williams goes down on a fastball. 7th strikeout for Sid Fernandez. And a 1-2-3 inning. The score at the end of 3.5 innings. It's the Mets 4 and the Giants 2. The Mets half of the fourth inning. They're leading by a score of 4-0. 2 runs in the first. 2 runs in the third. And we've just run across something that was presented to us actually by Rick Laws of the New York Mets regarding a home run by Gregg Jeffries. And a new rule evidently put into effect. It says here, players who performed at more than one position are considered for the position they played most often that year and are credited with their entire season's home run and RBI total. So Jeffries, with his 14th home run, does tie Jerry Buchek and Tim Tuffle for the most home runs by a second baseman by the New York Mets.
That's only as far as the Mets are concerned. Home run and RBI leaders by position. So in the Mets media guide, strictly as far as the Mets are concerned, then Jeffries now has tied Tuffle and Buchek for home runs as a second baseman.
But the overall home runs by a player by position are only credited when you hit a home run or drive in a run when you're playing the position. Here's Tim Tuffle, who lined out his first time up. 1 strike count. This time he hits a fly ball into left center fairly deep, and going back is Butler, and he makes the play. So Tuffle's hit the ball well twice, has nothing to show for it.
Butler, a good jump on this ball. Then he makes the basket catch. That was not by design. A lot of times an outfielder will lose the ball in the light and be forced to make the basket catch. That appeared to happen to Butler then.
And,
you know, this brings up the question of RBIs then. What about RBIs? As far as by position.
I'm sure it's all you get credited when you're playing that single position. Now, if you're an outfielder, it's just totaled in. Left field, center field, right field doesn't make any difference.
Why should it make a difference on the infield?
I don't know.
It doesn't as far as the Mets are concerned, though.
But in the case of Rogers Hornsby and Davey Johnson, that's the way it's credited. Most home runs by a second baseman in a single season, 42, by Rogers Hornsby and Davey Johnson. And Davey hit 43 that year, but one of them as a pinch hitter, and it wasn't added into that total. I guess it depends which way you want to look at it. And oh, the count to Todd Huntley. And he gets a strike called against him, 3-1. Huntley flied out to center field his first time up. And it's ball four, so Mike Lacoss walks Huntley and brings up Sid Fernandez, who singled his first time up. Mets fans, this break in the action is a good time for you to break open a nice cold Budweiser and enjoy that clean, crisp taste. Yeah, this Bud's for you.
What if Davey Johnson had gotten one of those home runs as, say, a third baseman that year, as opposed to a pinch hitter? Pinch hitting's not a position.
According to the rules that I know, it would not count it against the overall total, but according to Mets rules here and their press guide, it would have. Third walk issued by Lacoste, and it brings up Sid Fernandez in a bunting position. Sid with a single, his first time up, a hard line drive to right field with 9 hits now and 47 at bat. Williams very close, defending the third base. And Sid bunts it to the first base side and bunts it foul. Year that Davey Johnson hit the 43 home runs, he had more home runs than Hank Aaron, and it was the only time in the history of Major League Baseball that three players on the same team hit 40 or more home runs: Darryl Evans, Hank Aaron, and Davey Johnson, 1973. This ball bunted in the air and a chance for Carter, but he can't get to it. Good try by Gary.
I don't know whether it was or not. If he catches the ball, Huntley was tagged at first base. I think the sacrifice is successful.
Might have got down to second.
I don't think you ought to try to catch a ball like this. If you catch a ball like this and you do indeed make the play, your balance is so bad that you either fall down or your momentum's going to carry you back into the screen. And an alert base runner, and Huntley was certainly tagged and alert, he goes to second base.
Good point. By catching the ball in foul territory with the winning run scoring from third.
Right.
Here's a two-strike pitch, and this one is bunted up and will be playable. Carter makes the play, and Sid fails the sacrifice.
You ought to let that ball drop. If it stays foul, it's the third strike. Of course, you're trained to catch those balls. What if this ball, you saw Carter look down at first base. What if that ball hits the ground and bounces back fair? Then you go to second, first, might have a double play. But you're trained to catch him, and every time it goes up.
The reaction.
Yeah, it's like that sacrifice where the ball's bunted back to the pitcher in the air. Takes anticipation if you're going to drop it and then throw to first and try to double the runner off at first base.
Tom Seaver was very good at that.
Doug McGraw, yeah, the Mets taught that back in the early 70s. Rube Walker.
1-0 to Darryl Boston, who is 0-2. Good play on him his first time up by Williams at third. And he tops another one. This one will be fielded by Thompson. He goes to first for the out. That retires aside. So walking a man left to score at the end of four. It's the Mets 4 and San Francisco nothing. Now leading 4-0. And for San Francisco, the leadoff batter will be Gary Carter, the former Mets player.
Carter. I got a note today from John, who's an old Brooklyn fan. I guess that's his only name, John.
John Brooklyn.
An old Brooklyn fan, we were talking about those gnats the other day that caused the closing of the Sky Dome the other night up in Toronto, 35 minutes. And John says that a game was called at Ebbets Field back in the middle 40s with Ralph Branca pitching because of nets around home plate. Not called, delayed.
I had to talk with Ralph about that.
Yeah.
Number 13, as Howard Cosell would say.
Number 13. Yeah.
Carter struck out his first time up, swinging at a high fastball. Now he gets another fastball, misses it, 1-1. Carter hitting 255 for the Giants with 8 home runs, 24 runs batted in. He has been in a batting slump. He's had just 6 hits in his last 19 ball games. A swing and a miss, and it's 1-2.
Yeah, he's now 6 for his last 50, and his average has plummeted to 255.
.120 batting average over those last 20 ball games. Here's the 1-2 pitch, and Sid back with a fastball. It's grounded out to Johnson, who handles it. And Magadan, who has really loosened up playing to first base. He has real confidence playing over there now. Makes a good play on the throw.
Ojo's throw is to the right of Magadan, and he digs it out. Nice play by Magadan.
So one away here in the fifth, and that'll bring up Rob Thompson, who has struck out. Fernandez struck out the side in the second. Has 8 strikeouts on the game, and the first pitch is fouled back into the stand. Thompson has really worn the Mets out in his major league career, with the exception of this year. He's hitting .332 against the Mets in his major league games against New York. But this year, he is 3-for-22, hitting .136. He does have one of his 4 home runs that he's hit against the Mets this year. That home run off Sid Fernandez, and the pitch is taken for a ball, 1 ball, 1 strike. Mark Dewey in the bullpen for the Giants. The Giants have had so many roster changes, it's unbelievable. And the ball does not hit him, so it's just a ball, and it's 2-1.
I think it's 25 different pitchers now. They had 15 starters last year, did the Giants. They have used 25 different pitchers this year. The major league record, 27 during a season. And the last team to do that, the 1967 Mets. But, of course, they did it for a different reason. They were a building ball club, only their 6th year in operation.
You're right, Tim. On as of August 26th, and it might even be more now, 25 different pitchers. They had 27 of the pitchers suited up, but they didn't actually pitch. 13 starters. It has been a tough year for Al Rosen, the general manager of the Giants. The 27 pitchers as of that date ties a major league high, the 1915 Philadelphia Athletics, who finished 58 and a half games out that year, the 1955 Kansas City A's, who finished 33 and a half games out. The Giants are really still in this race, even though they've used all those pitchers.
And the 67 Mets, they're the last team to do it.
A little fly ball that will drop in the right center, so Thompson picks up the second hit for the Giants, the runner on with one out, and Jose Uribe the batter. 67 Mets finished 40 and a half games out. But the Giants, in spite of all those pitchers that had to be used because of injuries and whatever, started this ball game 7 and a half games out.
But again, yeah, I think you can really make that distinction, and that's important. The 55 Kansas City Athletics, what was that, the first year that they had moved from Philadelphia to Kansas City? Right in that area.
Right in there.
And then, so they were building ball club for the most part. And then in 1967, the Mets are building ball club. So what the Giants have done is they've competed with all of those pitchers. And that's a much more difficult thing to do
amazing
than the other teams, yeah.
you can understand when you're losing all those games, you keep trying new players. But when you're trying to win and then a pennant race, and having to do all that, you're really doing a good job to stay alive.
Who was the 1915 team? Wasn't that the Athletics?
Athletics,
team?
Right.
Yeah, and I think that was when Connie Mack traded off all his good players after that 1914 season. And they had a lot of different players. So I think, as a matter of fact, they're the only team in the American League to win the pennant and finish last, or the last team to do it. Not sure about that. But those other three examples are so unique in that they're different from the Giants, because the Giants have competed using all those different pitches.
Rather interesting thing how they've kept this team together with Spit and String, I guess. Two strikes to count. Uribe, the batter, and he swings and misses. Strikeout number 9 for Sid Fernandez. And we're in the fifth.
Strikeout number 9. Fernandez has struck out at least one in every inning. He struck out the side in the second, two in the third and fourth, and one here in the fifth.
You're watching Mets Baseball 90 on WWOR-TV, Secaucus, New Jersey. And the first pitch to Mike Lacoss. Ball one. Lacoss sacrificed his first time up. Fastball foul back. One ball, one strike. Lacoss, a veteran of many years.
I'll tell you, if I were Robbie Thompson on first base, you wouldn't normally try to steal, but the Mets are playing behind Thompson, and if he were to try to steal, if he makes it, Lacoss is hitting with a guy at second. If he gets thrown out, then a pinch hitter is going to hit for Lacoss to lead off the sixth.
There he goes, and there's the throw by Huntley, and it's not in time, and the ball gets away from Johnson covering there. So Roger Craig, listening to you, Tim, because that was a good play, because he would go to a pinch hitter if he let off the next inning.
Exactly. See, the Mets are playing behind Thompson, and normally if there are two outs and the pitcher's hitting, you wouldn't try to steal. But in this case, if Thompson's thrown out, the pinch hitter's going to lead off the sixth inning anyway. So that changed, and Roger Craig, very savvy baseball man, takes advantage of it.
So Roger, the Dodger, and that's exactly what he was. He started his career with the Brooklyn Dodgers. Was the first pitcher for the Mets to lose 20 ball games, and was their best pitcher that year in 1962. He won 10 and lost 24. He says you have to be a good pitcher to lose that many games. 2-2. And it's strike three. So even though the strategy was good, it didn't help. On the strikeout, Thompson left at second base. And the score at the end of 4.5 innings, it's the Mets 4 and the Giants nothing. Now here's a word from Nissan.
It off for the Mets. Been a happy day so far for the Mets. They are ahead 4-0, and Magadan's been right in the middle of it.
McGraw just won over his number, 46.
46 for number 45. 0-1 to Magadan. He has walked twice and scored twice. Inside, ball one.
Ball
that type ratio anymore. 192 walks, 138 Ks. This one lifted to left field. Kevin Mitchell almost in his tracks makes the play. One away here in the fifth inning, and Gregg Jeffries coming up. Big night for Gregg. It used to be, Ralph, that, you know, a youngster coming up from the minor leagues, you look at his minor league career, and it was not unusual to see that he had walked twice as many times as he had struck out. But you don't see that too often anymore. There are a lot of reasons for it, in my opinion. Long-term contract, guys aren't encouraged to take in the minors, with the idea that by taking, you're going to get better pitches to hit, and therefore be a better hitter.
Joe DiMaggio is one of the unbelievable records in baseball. He has quite a few of them. Struck out, I believe, at 363 times in his career. And he was a power hitter.
Did he strike out seven times during that streak in 1941?
Whole year. He hit 56 consecutive games. I think he only had something like 13 strikeouts for the whole season.
1-1 to Jeffries, one out, nobody on. 4-0 Mets here in the fifth. This one hit deep to right. Back is Litton, middle of the track, and he makes the play. Talk about getting the wood on the ball. Jeffries has done it three times tonight. He has scored twice with two RBIs, a home run, and a single.
Right here, he just misses his second home run, just a fraction underneath the sweet spot of the ball. Curls the crowd, but it's enough.
Strawberry now 1-for-2 with an RBI. This one hit hard to left field. Mitchell flipped, and now he can't get to it. It short hops the fence, and Strawberry has a double.
Well, Darryl goes the other way, and Mitchell, after slipping out there, starting, not able to catch up to it, and it bounces over his head, fielded by Butler, and the throw-in not in time. So Strawberry with his second hit of the game.
Saw Mitchell trying to get that carom. It looked like an inbound pass that Butler got, and Mitchell going up for it, and Butler makes the play. Here's McReynolds, the curveball's a strike. Towards third, off the glove and hand of Williams. Boy, that ball took a wicked top spin hop. It probably will be a base hit.
Well, the ball plays Williams instead of Williams playing the ball. He backs up and gets that tough hop, gets his bare hand on it. And it is scored a base hit. But he backed up in the play, and that made it even tougher.
Hit number six for the Mets. They lead 4-0, trying to add on. They have runners at the corners, two outs here in the fifth inning. 4-6-0 for the Mets, 0-2-0 for the Giants. Johnson goes too far. Here's that carom we were talking about, the left field. Now watch Mitchell. It's almost like he were receiving an inbound pass in basketball. Over the head of Mitchell, right to Butler. And the Giants take it down court. 0-1 to Johnson. Deep to right, 7-0 Mets.
better home run call, but I didn't have time.
Wow.
Well, that brings Roger Craig out of the dugout. Jeffries hitting the home run, and now Johnson. For Howard Johnson, his 16th home run as a left-hand batter. And his 20th home run for the season. There was no doubt about it, Tim making the call. It was gone.
However brief, right? This call to the bullpen is brought to you by New York Telephone, who reminds you that we're all connected. And we'll take a break for New York.
Mark Dewey will be the new pitcher. He's 0-0 with an earned run average of zero. He's been in three ball games. He's worked three innings. Brought up from Shreveport and Phoenix. He was 1-5 at Shreveport, and at Phoenix he was 2-2. And he was San Francisco's 23rd round draft choice in June of 1987.
So Dewey in relief of Lacoste, and Tim Tuffle takes the fastball inside. That ball wasn't that close. Ball and no strikes, but there again, the overreaction by the fans here. And everywhere in baseball, there is such an overreaction and a hypersensitivity to anything thrown inside. Outside, 2-0 to Tuffle. And a strike to Tuffle. The Mets with two in the first, two in the third, and three here in the fifth inning.
Bill White, the National League president, has told the umpires that you're not to stop any fights. You should try to get in between them, but if they get by you and go on and start fighting, let it go.
Fly ball, right field. Almost in his tracks is Greg Litton, but the damage done. The caption tomorrow morning should be Lacoste accosted. 7-0 Mets after 5. We're back after this from Express Mail. They started it off with two runs in the first and lead 7-0 here in the sixth. Inside to Brett Butler, who is 1-for-2, a bunt base hit back in the first inning. Way inside, ball two.
Well, the last eight games of 1.54 ERA, including tonight.
I think that's what they're going to need, too, throughout September to win the National League East Division. The Mets can blow you out, there's no question about it, but you get them in a 4-3-3-2 ball game, it's tough for them to win. It's tough for them to come up with a big hit. Now, they could all get hot together in September.
As they did in June.
Uh-huh. 24-4 during one stretch in June, but before that, when Buddy Harrelson took over, 20-22, and they've been mediocre since the All-Star break. A bunt attempt is fouled off, so it's 2-2 to Brett Butler.
Since the All-Star break, 25-24. Under Bud, they're 52-33. And he lost four of his first five games as manager of the Mets. Giants have had a tough time since the All-Star break. They're 23-23. While Cincinnati has been 23-25. The Dodgers, the hot ball club since the All-Star break, they are 30-16. And they are in the pennant race. They're 5.5 games back to Cincinnati.
Dodgers losing tonight in Philadelphia 2-1, that game in the fifth inning. Cincinnati losing also 1-0, that game in the top of the fifth in Chicago. Butler fouls it away. Butler, after that bunt base hit in the first inning, stole second base. He was there with nobody out, but he was stranded at third base. on a check swing by Kevin Mitchell. Should be an easy play for Johnson. It is. One out here in the sixth inning. This copyrighted telecast is authorized under television rights granted by the New York Mets solely for the entertainment of our audience. Any publication, reproduction, or use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of the New York Mets and Sterling AA Enterprises LP and WWOR-TV is prohibited. Any commercial or other use of the program, such as by charging admission for its showing, similarly prohibited. Right on. One of your favorite words, mine too. Gregg Litton. Not prohibited, similarly. 1-0 to Litton, who struck out twice. High strike, 1-1 to Gregg. Of any other pitcher in baseball who can tell you that a fastball is coming and just blow it right by you any more consistently than Sid Fernandez. 1-2 to Litton.
His first loss in his major league career was to the Giants while pitching for the Dodgers
back in 1983 as he fouls this one off. That was October 1, '83. Make that October 2, 1983, when he lost to the Dodgers. The Giants have never beaten him here at Shea, and he's never won a game at Candlestick. 3-4 lifetime against the Giants. Ball 2-2.
And actually, Candlestick should be a good park for him to pitch in, because right-hand batters, and that's what they use mostly against it, have to hit into that wind in left field.
Good
Billy
point.
Pierce made a living there pitching for the Giants, letting batters hit long fly balls to left into the wind.
Well, there's Litton again. That's strikeout number 11 now for Fernandez. Two outs, and here comes Will Clark.
5 2/3 innings. He's given up just two hits, and he has walked just one while striking out 11. That's his high in strikeouts this year.
Not his career. He struck out 16 Atlanta Braves last year and lost the ball game 3-2 on a home run by Lonnie Smith in the ninth inning. Those 16 strikeouts, by the way, came in 8-plus innings.
You know, Lonnie Smith was the first batter
right.
Leading off the ninth inning, so he didn't get a chance to pitch that inning and possibly pick up three more strikeouts.
To tie the National League record of 19 held by Carlton, Seaver, one and one to Will Clark. Am I missing anyone?
No, that's it in the National League, of course. Roger Clemens has 20 for the Major League record. Nolan Ryan had 19.
Most amazing thing about the Clemens game, he walked no one against Seattle in 1986. Roger the Rocket.
One of the most amazing things about baseball, Steve Carlton lost his game that he struck out 19.
No kidding.
Against the Mets, you were catching.
Yeah, what do you think, he was throwing against the wall that night? I'm the guy who threw the... Who threw those two run homers to Ron Swoboda? So naturally, my fault, right?
I'm sure the pitcher thought so. Why'd you call that pitch?
Should have walked him. Both times. Still 2-2 to Clark.
That's why Steve Garland's a hermit up there in, what is it, Montana's? Where is
it? Durango, Colorado. Lefty is making his home now in Durango, Colorado. I'm sure he loves us telling everybody that he lives in Durango. Lefty, very quiet, of course. Didn't talk to the press, didn't talk to too many people during his career. And I said a long time ago that it wouldn't surprise me if he became a hunting guide in Montana and just disappeared. Well, he's almost done that. Fly ball right center, an easy play for Darryl Boston. And that's the third out. Sid Fernandez is greasing, as greasy as the weather. 7-0 Mets, middle of the sixth. We're back after this from Anheuser-Busch. Off for the Mets here in the bottom of the sixth with New York on top. 7-0, and this one to Robbie Thompson's left, and it will probably be a base hit for Todd Hundley. And it is. So hit number 8 for the Mets, and the first for Hundley tonight.
Thompson, a very fine fielding second baseman, has made only 7 errors so far this year. He gets over there, gets a piece of it, but can't hold on to it. So Todd with a welcome base hit.
It's a base hit smile right there. Sid Fernandez now has struck out and singled. And the bunt attempt is unsuccessful. So it's 0-1 to Sid Fernandez.
Sid failed to sacrifice in the fourth inning, getting another chance here.
It's going to be really tough to sacrifice with Williams and Clark converging along with Dewey.
Wouldn't be surprised if they let him hit away.
Good time to do it. And he bunched this one beautifully. You couldn't have drawn a circle and put it in a better spot than Fernandez did. Hundley moves to second. He's there with one out, and Darryl Boston coming up.
This is the only place he could have bunted the ball. Well, it was no more than 50 feet away at third base, so he makes Clark field it, and the sacrifice does work.
And Roger Craig has not had a lot to be happy about this evening after his club came from behind to beat Montreal last night. Game-winning home run by Robbie Thompson off Bill Stampin of the Expos, after Kevin Mitchell had tied it with a home run off Stampin. It has been a quiet evening for the Giants tonight. It's 7-0 New York, and ball one to Darryl Boston. Strike on the corner, 1-1 to Darryl. Like a split finger right there from Mark Dewey in relief of Mike Lacoss.
And Mark, with that ball breaking down and way, would certainly indicate it was a split finger fastball.
Yeah.
Another one
right there, and that gets Boston. So two outs for the Mets here in the sixth inning, a 7-0 lead, and Dave Nagin is coming up. Talking to Pat Dobson, the pitching coach of the Padres, on Tuesday night. And Dobber telling me that one of the biggest changes that he has seen, that split finger fastball, is that pitchers don't reacquire the grip on the breaking ball as easily after throwing that split finger fastball. He mentioned a couple of cases, but I've never heard it. The grip on the curveball and the slider is different after becoming accustomed to the grip on the split finger fastball. Outside, 1-1 to Magadan.
Ron Darling would be a case in point. He came to the Mets with a fastball and curveball, now relies mainly on the fastball split finger.
Good example, that's right. Ball two, 2-0 to Dave Magadan. Mets have had everything good you can have in a game tonight. Power, pitching, fielding. not a lot left. They lead 7-0 here in the sixth inning. Ball three to Dave.
They've also been helped out by three walks. And a chance for four here with Magadan batting with a 3-1 count. He's walked twice. Scored twice.
Now he does walk for the third time. So Magadan, even though he's been up four times, is 0-for-1 officially tonight. That'll bring up Gregg Jeffries. Oh, look at that shot. It's like a garter belt around her head. Not a garter belt, but a garter.
It's a crowd. Looks like grandfather.
Looks like a garter around her head. Could be. Cute little shot, all dressed in pink, huh? No balls, one strike to Gregg Jeffries. Speaking of belts, he belted out two hits tonight. A two-run homer in the third, a single, and a run scored in the first inning. So a big night for Jeffries. He's 2-for-3, two runs with two RBI.
Jeffries, unlike Darryl Strawberry in Los Angeles, his hometown, Darryl not hitting at all in L.A., and Jeffries' hometown, San Francisco, and he has a lifetime average of 356 against the Giants.
Flying sharply, but Uribe is there, the shortstop. The Mets go down in the sixth inning, but have a rather comfortable 7-0 lead as we go to the seventh after this from Nike. Comfortable lead for the Mets, and back in to call it for you. Here's Ralph.
All right, Tim, and for the Giants, it'll be Kevin Mitchell to lead it off. Kevin is 0-for-2. Giants have just two hits, and Sid Fernandez with 11 strikeouts through his first six innings. Mitchell has grounded out and was called out on strikes, got caught looking at a curveball. Fernandez with a record of 8-10. And the first pitch to Mitchell, a fastball for strike one. Dodgers 2, the Phillies 2. That's in the top of the sixth. Dodgers 5.5 games back of Cincinnati. And Cincinnati jumping out in front now, leading Chicago by a score of 3-1. Now they've added two more to make it 5-1. So Cincinnati leading the Dodgers by 5.5 and San Francisco by 7.5, making it tough on the Dodgers and Giants. Two strikes to count to Mitchell.
Scoreboard, Ralph was talking about it. It's 2-2, L.A. at Philadelphia. That game in the sixth inning now. The Cardinals losing to Atlanta down at Fulton County Stadium. 3-2 in the seventh inning. And a big five spot for the Reds. They're still hitting in the top of the fifth. 5-1 over Chicago.
7-0 here as the Mets lead the Giants. And the batter will be Matt Williams. And Williams takes time for ball one. Williams has struck out twice, both times looking. Little of each, a curveball one time, a fastball. And back with a fastball, one ball, one strike. The Giants at one point, 11 games under 500. That was back on May 28th. Had a record of 17-28. Got back to 10 games over 500, but now have been slipping. And they are now 5 games under 500. The 2-1 pitch to Williams, a good fastball, 2-2. Goal for 15.
And 4 for his last 27.
But coming into this game, hitting 275 with 26 home runs, 97 runs batted in. Tied for the big lead in RBI. Again, the fastball, and that's the third time he has struck out. Sid gets number 12.
That's what we were saying. You know the fastball's coming, and you still swing through it. Nissan American League scoreboard, 4-3, the White Sox over the Twins. Oakland maintains their 6.5 game lead, defeating Kansas City 6-5. 5-0, Baltimore over the Yankees down Baltimore way, that game in the sixth inning. 2-1, Cleveland over the front-running Boston Red Sox in the seventh, and Detroit at Seattle later on.
And the batter, Gary Carter. Gary looking, and it's called a strike. Carter struck out his first time up, grounded out his second. He has a lifetime average of 304 as you look at Bud Harrelson, enjoying this ball game. That lifetime average against the Mets was 304. But most of it accumulated while with Montreal. Roger Craig seeing this season slide away. They played in the World Series last year and lost to Oakland. And that pitched a curve for a ball at 21. Carter with 24 home runs against the Mets, none of them as a Giant. And the fastball fouled back. 1-2. 53 career home runs at Shea. That's some great years for the New York Mets. The 1-2 pitch. Third ball that slips out of his hand, and it's 2-2.
To a foul ball in their boots.
Big three.
Some three.
And it popped up and to left center field. Boston making the call. And that retires the side. So Sid with eight in a row after the base hit by Rob Thompson, the GE line score, the Mets 7 and the Giants nothing. And we'll return right after this message. They lead by a score of 7-0 with Darryl Strawberry coming up. Darryl is 2-for-3 tonight with a run score. Darryl now hitting 277 with 28 home runs, 81 runs batted in. And the first pitch by Mark Dewey is taken outside for a ball. Two balls, no strike. Then a grounder out towards first base. Clark can't handle it. Now picks it out of the air, throws to first base in time, and after the bobble, a great recovery.
Well, I'll say. I guess you could say this is a recovery after the discovery of the ball right there in front of you. Great athletic reaction by Clark to get Strawberry.
A lot easier chance for Thompson right there in that play, but Clark coming off the bag and still making the play. And now Kevin McReynolds rounds it out to the shortstop, Uribe. His quick throw for the out. So two quick outs here in the bottom half of the seventh. The Mets leading 7-0. And the crowd here enjoying this ball game. 38,630. Total in the house, 40,405. That'll bring up Howard Johnson. Johnson with a three-run homer in the fifth inning to tack on three more runs after the Mets got two in the first and two in the third. Mets with two home runs in the ball game. Jeffries a two-run home run. That was in the third inning. Then Johnson with his three-run home run. And the first pitch is ball one. Mets with 139 home runs in the year. They're number one in the National League. Giants are third in the National League in home runs. They have 122. In between, there's a pitch of fastball outside. Johnson one for three tonight. And a strike call, so it's 2-1. Again, they count 3-1. Viola tomorrow night, 16-9 of the year against Don Robinson, the veteran who has a record of 10-4. Then two day games, Saturday and Sunday. This one popped up, and it will be playable. Matt Williams, the third baseman, makes the catch, and the Mets go in order. First time in the game. So the score at the end of 7, the Mets 7 and the Giants nothing. And here's a word from your 9X Yellow Pages. The first of four with the Giants. And for the Giants, it'll be Rob Thompson. This is how the Mets scored their runs. Bottom of the first, an RBI single by Strawberry. A sack fly by McReynolds, 2-0 Mets. Bottom of the third, a two-run homer by Jeffries. And the Mets leading 4-0. And then it was Howard Johnson in the bottom of the fifth with a three-run homer, scoring Strawberry and McReynolds, and the Mets on top by a score of 7-0. Thompson with one of the two hits by the Giants, singled in the right center back in the fifth. First hit, a bunt base hit by Brett Butler as he led off the ballgame. And the first pitch, strike one. Thompson one for two with a strikeout. Giants with two runners in scoring position in the ballgame. Butler got the third. Thompson got the second after a single on the stolen base. And the breaking ball for ball one. And it's 1-1. Thompson 7-for-19 against Sid Fernandez with a home run. One popped up on the second base side. It'll be taken by Magadan, and he makes the play easily. Thompson is out. That'll bring up Jose Uribe. Uribe, the eighth batter in the batting order, will have a pinch hitter for the pitcher, Mark Dewey. Francisco Oliveras throwing in the bullpen for the Giants. And the fastball. Ball one. Uribe with a walk and the strikeout. His lifetime average against the Mets, .267. But this year, hitting .440 against the Mets coming into this ballgame. 11 hits and 25 at bats. Doc Gooden pitched a great game last night and got an ND and no decision. Uribe broke Doc Gooden's winning streak.
Wait a minute. I noticed something different on Doc's left ear.
Is that a diamond?
Looked like it.
There it is. And they pitch a ball, so Uribe walks for the second time. The only two walks that Fernandez has given up. Talking about that winning streak that the doctor had, Uribe got a RBI infield base hit to stop Doc's winning streak in 14 consecutive games back in 1986. So Bill Bates will be the pinch hitter. Hitting 222 for the year. He has two home runs, eight runs batted in. Faith, the pinch hitter.
You'll remember last year's World Series, I'll tell you that.
Became the 21st player to hit a home run in his first at bat in the World Series.
Game four, a three-run shot, is only at bat during the series, one for one.
One ball, no strikes, as they have a conference at the mound.
Beg your pardon, he was up after that also. He was up two times. He stayed in the game in game four and got another base hit. I beg your pardon, took an over, so he's one for two in the series, but 21 times have players gone to bat in the World Series for the first time and homered, and Babe was one of them. Something you can take to the bank.
First to do it was Joe Harris of the Washington Senators back in 1925. 1-0 the count, and the fastball swung on a miss. Sid with 12 strikeouts. And he has given up just two singles, one of them an infield base hit, a bunt, the other a single to right center field, and he has walked two. Again, Magadan playing off the bag, but not that far off. This ball hit toward right field, Strawberry right there. So 2 minutes away, Uribe back to first base, and that'll bring up Brett Butler. Butler with a bunt base hit, one for three in tonight's ballgame. Have had a winning record against left-handed starters. They were 25 and 21. Against right-handed starters, 42 and 41, one game over. And the first pitch to Butler hit into the corner. It'll be extra bases. On his way to third base, Uribe, and the throw in will be relayed to the plate, but not in time, and there goes the shutout, and the ball gets away and goes into the dugout. And on the play, Butler will go over to third base and now on in. So two bases on the overthrow, and all of a sudden the Giants have two runs and the shutout down the drain for Sid Fernandez.
I think Todd Hundley tried to make too quick a tag. Butler sits on the fastball inside and hits it hard down the right field line. The throw by Strawberry hits the relay man, but look where the relay man is. Tim Tuffle is about 10 feet in foul territory. He throws the ball back across his body. How can Tuffle be that far over? Why would you want to be that far over?
I have no idea why he'd be in foul territory, because the base hit was not that far over by the foul line.
If you're lining yourself up with home plate, I mean, Timmy had to catch the ball and then throw it back across his body. Here it is one more time. Now the Mets have two relay men, the second baseman and the first baseman. Now watch Strawberry hit the first relay man, and that's Tuffle. Darryl looking up and saying, wait a minute. There's Magadan. If that ball was overthrown, that might have ended up in the Mets dugout. As it stands, it ends up in the Giants dugout. And they have two runs and not one.
So it's now 7-2, and the pitch to Greg Litton, ball four. So Litton, who had struck out his first three times up, finally gets on base. And the Giants have their hopes kept alive. Third walk given up by Sid Fernandez, the second in this inning, and it will bring up Will Clark and the Giants with one of their best hitters at the plate.
This might be Sid's last man, regardless of what happens. Alejandro Pena is warming up. And if you're familiar with Sid Fernandez, you know he goes in a hurry. And that's not only Sid, that's pitchers of his ilk. They throw those high fastballs. And when you run out of gas with a high fastball, you still throw them, but they're not as fast. You're in trouble. With Pena warming up hurriedly in the Mets bullpen.
Clark has had two home runs against Sid this year, and he hits the ball hard to the shortstop. It goes on through in the center field. Litton on his way to third, and he'll go there with a throw going into second base. So all of a sudden now, the Giants starting to show some fire as they have two runs in and runners at first and third, trailing by a score of 7-2. And here comes Bud Harrelson out to the mound. Watching Mets Baseball 90 on WWOR-TV, Secaucus, New Jersey, and Sid Fernandez out of the ballgame after working 7 2/3 innings. So far, charged with two runs, one of them unearned. At this point, he has allowed just four base hits while striking out a total of 12 batters. And sit on the winning side of the ballgame out of the game. And here's a word from Nissan. Sid Fernandez with 119 pitches, 43 balls, 76 strikes, and 12 strikeouts.
So Sid being relieved by Alejandro Pena, and the numbers for Pena. Alejandro will be facing his first hitter, but he does have a put out tonight, right?
On Jeffries' home run.
How can you have a put out and not play a game? Well, Pena's done it. And here it is, right here, the home run by Gregg Jeffries in the third inning. Watch Pena in the bullpen. Litton back, and it's Pena who makes the play.
Now he has his job to perform here after making the defensive play of the game. Positioned perfectly out there.
Right.
And it's Kevin Mitchell, and he hits the first pitch high in the air. And Boston is right there for the out, and that retires the side and ends the rally. So Pena, one pitch to put out the fire. Two runs scoring, one unearned on two hits and a walk. And the score at the end of 7.5 innings. The Mets 7, the Giants 2, and now here's a word from Federal Express.
Ferris out there, and his numbers.
And Oliveras will be working to Tim Tuffle, who's hitting tough luck here tonight. Two line drives were caught, one of them an outstanding play by Williams at third, and a bullet hit by Tuffle. Tuffle 0-3. And Oliveras with a fastball for ball one. And Tuffle hits it hard but pulls it foul. One ball, one strike to Tuffle, the second baseman. Mets leading 7-2. They have 7 runs on 8 hits. The Giants 2 runs on 4. Fastball foul back. 1-2. Giants have won 5 of the 8 games played between these two clubs here at Shea Stadium. Each club has won 1. Giants came into this game with 5 wins in their last 7 games. And there's a base hit for Tuffle. So finally he breaks through after some tough luck hitting. And the Mets have a base runner.
Fans, after every game this season, points will be awarded to Mets pitchers for the AT&T Long Distance Award. I think you're familiar with how it works. For every inning pitch, you get a point. We'll also add in the fraction. If a pitcher is credited with a complete game, he gets a bonus point. At the end of the season, the man on top will win the AT&T Long Distance Award.
And the Mets with a runner at first base and no one out, and Todd Huntley the batter. Huntley 1-2. at an infield base hit his first time up, and he takes the first pitch for strike one. Huntley, a switch hitter. And the fastball for a ball, one ball, one strike. His father, Randy Huntley, an outstanding catcher in the major leagues, mainly for the Chicago Cubs, and the man who started the fantasy camp.
He just spoke with him last night.
One and two on the foul ball.
Todd speaking with his dad last night. They speak frequently, exchanging notes about catching in the big leagues. Tell you, he should have exchanged a note with Jay Horowitz, our publicity director. Todd got married last winter and didn't tell Jay. So Jay came out with a press guide and it says in it that he's single. Well, Todd's wife, Tiffany, gave birth to their first little baby girl 2 weeks ago.
There's a drive into the corner, and it will be extra bases. Coming around third and being held there is Tuffle, and the new father has an extra base hit.
Fifth double of the year for proud papa, Todd Huntley. I'll tell you what Todd Huntley can do. He can run. He is quick. Of course, that'll slow down after a while.
Just
catch
him
for a
time.
While. Trust me.
That was his 10th base hit, and 5 of his base hits have been 2 base hits. Puts runners at second and third with no one out and brings up Alejandro Pena, and he swings hard and misses strike one. Pena at one point was an infielder and converted to pitching, so he is a little better hitter than most pitchers. Hitting .333 this year, 1-for-3. And it's grounded out to the shortstop, bobbled by Uribe. And he might have been distracted by the head of that bat flying out there with the ball. And we'll see how it scores.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. That bat flying out there, and Uribe doesn't know which to field first. I tell you, the memories come back so vividly. In 1962, Duke Snyder was batting against Larry Jackson in spring training, and the bat broke, and the bat eventually landed in Larry Jackson's face. It broke his jaw. And the reason I tell that story, Ralph, Larry Jackson passed away yesterday. I don't know if you caught that. 59 years old, died of cancer. And I was just talking to Darryl Johnson this evening before the game about that very play. It happened in spring of 1962.
And the next pitch to Boston, the ball, so it's 2-0. Jackson, an outstanding pitcher.
Classy guy, boy. Sure taught me a lot. I didn't retain a lot of it.
Boston 0-for-4 in this game. A chance to pick up a couple of RBIs. Bases loaded. That was scored an error on Uribe. And it popped up. Williams over. Does he have room? He does. And he makes the catch. For Boston, 0-for-5 now, and a chance to pick up some RBIs and losing that. And that'll bring up Dave Magadan, who has not had a base hit tonight, but he has been on base 3 times as a result of walks. He is 0-for-1. Magadan with 49 runs batted in. Mets leading 7-2 as they bat here in the 8th with one man out. Bases loaded. Francisco Oliveras on the mound for the Giants, their third pitcher. Mike Lacoss, the pitcher record on the losing side. And the first pitch popped out over the head of the pitcher. Good play by Thompson as he comes in to pick up the out, but an RBI for Magadan. And Tuffle scores on the play.
Yeah, that's the only thing that Thompson, Robinson could do with that high chopper over the mound. Once it gets by Oliveras, you know Magadan's going to have an RBI. It's not hit hard enough to get to second. And it wasn't hit hard enough for Thompson to come home on the ball to try to get shuffled. Only one play.
And it brings up Gregg Jeffries, and he takes the fastball for ball one. Jeffries, 2-for-4 tonight. One of his hits a two-run home run. Mets now leading 8-2 with 10 base hits to the Giants 4. And ball two, two balls, no strikes to Jeffries. Jeffries in the top 10 in six categories. And he is tied for the most doubles in the National League, and that's ball three, three balls, no strikes. Jeffries checking out to see whether or not he's hitting. Taken, and it's ball four, so the Mets again have the bases loaded, and the batter will be Darryl Strawberry. Roger Craig watching a tough ball game, and the first pitch to Strawberry, a fastball, a call strike. Strawberry 2-for-4 tonight, a single and a double. He has a run scored, no runs batted in, but a chance for almost a handful here. And the fastball again, catching that inside corner as it tails back over the corner. It's strike two.
Darryl, you see Darryl on that pitch, often confused and fooled on that tailing fastball. He doesn't think that ball's a strike. That pitch is a strike. That ball that comes back right under his arm.
And the two-strike pitch, and it goes outside, and it just misses. One and two to count.
Here's that 0-1 pitch we were talking about. Now watch that ball run back over the plate. See, that ball's a strike. Darryl has those long arms, and he really gets fooled on that pitch often.
And the 1-2 pitches, they come back again inside. This one is off the plate. It's 2-2. Kevin McReynolds on deck. Mets have had three Grand Slam home runs this year. Last year, Kevin McReynolds, the only man to have a Grand Slam home run for the Mets. And he goes to ball three. So a full count, 2 men out. The runners will be running with the pitch. Francisco Oliveras will work from the stretch. The carousel will be turning. The runners go, and the pitch is hit to deep right field, and it's gone goodbye. A Grand Slam home run for Darryl Strawberry. And it marks the anniversary of his last Grand Slam home run. By Kevin McReynolds. So on this date last year, Kevin McReynolds with a Grand Slam home run, the only one the Mets have, and Darryl Strawberry with his first this year.
Happy anniversary.
Spread it around.
Yeah.
So the Mets now leading by a 12-2 score, and the batter Kevin McReynolds, and he takes for strike one.
That's only the fourth home run by Strawberry since July 23rd. And you might say, well, big deal, the Mets have it already won. And that might be true. However, this might be the thing that gets Strawberry going and carries him through the last month. Man, what a monster shot that was.
And McReynolds with a count of strike two. Here's another look at it.
Strawberry. That was another look at it by Strawberry. Wow. Smoked up.
So the Mets leading 12-2 here as they pick up their 11th hit. And a happy bit for the New York Mets. And it's strike three. So McReynolds ends the inning, but the Mets send eight men to the plate. They score a total of five runs. The big blow, the grand slam home run by Darryl Strawberry. And the score at the end of eight. It's the Mets 12 and the Giants 2. And here's a word from Nike. Pena's fastball for ball two. Two balls, no strikes.
That's the funny thing about that save rule, even though it's a 10-run ball game, because Pena pitched out of a tough position for the Mets in the eighth inning. He will be awarded as a save should he finish this game.
And Williams, who has struck out the three times he has been up, fouls off a fastball, and it's two balls and one strike. Dodgers leading Philadelphia 3-2, that game in the bottom of the eighth inning. Cincinnati leading Chicago 6-4, that game in the seventh. And that's strike two, and it's 2-2. Dodgers starting 5.5 games back of Cincinnati. The Giants 7.5 games back of the Reds. Pittsburgh idle, so the Mets can pick up a half game on the Pirates. There'll be a game and a half back. One game behind in the loss column. And Williams fouls it off, so the count will stay at 2-2. A lot more action on this homestand Friday night, Saturday afternoon, and Sunday afternoon. And tickets available for the game. And we advise you, with the tennis going on across the street, to take the subway out here. Or the Long Island Railroad, and this one grounded out to third. Jeffries falls down, gets up, makes the throw, and it's picked out by Magadan, and a fine play by Jeffries as he is quick as a cat.
Just scampering back to his feet, watching fall down, and then he uses the glove and his hand for leverage, and he gets up and throws out Matt Williams. Good play.
So Williams 0 for 4 for the night. Now to bring up Gary Carter, who's 0 for 3. And a breaking ball for ball one. Carter hitting 251 with 8 home runs, 24 runs batted in. And the fastball. But outside, two balls and no strikes. Carter in July had a 5-for-5 day against the Cubs. And that's ball three, three balls and no strikes. This is his 17th year in the major league, all in the National League. The 3-0 pitch, ball four, so Pena walks Carter. And that'll bring up Rob Thompson. Thompson 1-for-3 tonight.
Ladies and gentlemen, your attention please. Batting for Robbie Thompson.
And now we're going to have a pinch hitter for Thompson. That's going to be Ernest Riles, who's hitting 241. One home run. make that 7 home runs, 19 runs batted in. He's had a fine year as a pinch hitter. He's 11 for 30 as a pinch hitter with 4 home runs, and he's driven in 12. One of his home runs, a grand slam home run. Hitting 241 in the year with 7 home runs. And the fastball fouled away, strike two. Hitting 367 as a pinch hitter with 12 runs batted in. Carter not being held on the first base by Magadan. Magadan about 5 steps behind him. And this one grounded to Tuffle, who'll try for 2. They get one, but not the other, as the ball is thrown away, but no error in the play as Ryle stays at first base.
Tim Tuffle delays on the throw to second base. Watch, a double clutch right there. Can't get it out of his glove, and Johnson's overthrow. They wouldn't have had Riles anyway, but fortunately it hits the photographer's booth, and that prevents an error on Johnson,
who has not made an error since taking over at shortstop with Elster.
Right.
Elster on the DL. So that'll bring up Jose Uribe, who has been on twice on walks. He also scored a run. And this one hit up the middle. So Uribe continues to pound on the Mets this year. That is his 12th hit in 27 advance, and Riles goes over to third on the single. In case you're wondering, that home run, the grand slam home run by Strawberry, all 4 of those runs were unearned as a result of Uribe's error that prolonged the inning. One of the 2 runs the Giants have is unearned. And Mike Kingery is a batter, as a pinch hitter. Kingery hitting 264 for the year. No home runs, 19 runs batted in. He is 5 for 13 as a pinch hitter with 4 runs batted in. First pitch fouled away, strike one. Mets leading 12-2. 2 men out. We're in the top of the ninth inning. And they pitch a ball, and it's 1 ball and 1 strike.
If a fishery is a place that holds fish, what would a kingery be? A castle?
Place of the old kings, absolutely. Now the 1-1 pitch. Breaking ball for a ball. It's 2 balls and 1 strike.
Just a thought.
Just a thought. We're trying to think about it. 2-1 the count. And the fastball catches the inside corner, 2-2, and Pena a strike away from ending this ballgame. With the Phillies scoring 9 runs against the Dodgers to beat them in the game 10-9, you almost are afraid to count anything in baseball today. Now the 2-2 pitch. It is fouled away. Craig hoping that the Giants can stay in this race. If Cincinnati wins their ball game, they're leading 6-4 over the Cubs, and the Giants lose this, they'll be 8.5 games out. Bud Harrelson will move to within 1.5 games of the Pirates. The Pirates not playing today. And that's it. So the Mets with a laugher as they win it by a score of 12-2. Sid Fernandez, the winning pitcher, he is now 9-10. The loser and starter for the Giants, Mike Lacoss, his record 4-3. A save for Pena, his fourth save of the year. And we'll be back with a recap. The final score, the Mets 12 and the Giants 2. And here's a word from Delta Airlines.